an inspiration, really, to drive by the house and see what Patty Thurston has done from top to bottom, inside and out, with a great deal of care and attention to the details and to the whole spirit of the building, really. And we judged that this was really an obvious choice this year to the board, and certainly one which should set the standard for years to come. And I must say, I have walked up and down Main Street this spring, and you can hear people as you pass them saying, "My, isn't that a wonderful job?" And I'm sure that you would agree, it is. I would also add that when the former owner of the house says how delighted she is to see it looking still like the house she remembers, but with a new life to it, that too is very, very nice to hear. Before I call Patty up here, I thought I would like to read to you a paragraph from Randy's book, Oxford County Maine, which tells a little bit about the house. And I'm sure you have seen this in the book, but these are the little details that we consider. "The finest Italianate residence in Bethel, and one of the most important in Oxford County, is the Samuel D. Philbrook House on Main Street in Bethel. Connected to a two-story L and large gable-roofed barn, the nearly square residence was completed by carpenter Edmund Merrill early in 1879 and replaced an earlier structure destroyed by fire the previous year. The picturesque effect of the style is achieved through the development of strongly three-dimensional architectural elements. Most notable here are the bay windows, bracketed door hood, and centered gable on the three-bayed symmetrical facade. Above the projecting eaves with elaborated cornice is a distinctive square cupola displaying inverted scroll-like brackets at the lower corners, pairs of round arch windows, and a tent roof with wooden finial." And then it goes on to talk about the grounds. "The landscaped grounds, curved in cut granite, once sported an equally exuberant gazebo, which now stands in restored condition on the grounds of the Moses Mason House on Broad Street." So Patty, would you please come up here?
John pulled me by the hair, kicking and screaming. He said he was taking me to Bethel, Maine. I was like the Garfield cat, you know, as we're leaving Boston, plastered against the window. And it's taken me a while. I've had about 9 different careers since coming here, and it's nice that I think I finally found something that, hopefully, something I can do well. I'm basically unemployable, so. I just thank you very much for this honor.
Someone I've known for quite a few years. I was a graduate student. I was bumped out of the graduate dorm at the University of Maine in 1967 because my application was tied up in a mail strike in Canada. And so I ended up in an undergraduate dorm called Oak Hall. Some of you know the University of Maine, know Oak Hall. And one of the people that live just down the hall from me was Richard Dean, our speaker tonight. So I'm interested to see that our paths crossed many times. And of course, all of you know Parents Farmers Union. You know he's very often there helping you out on various questions. I had to talk to him and several other people about my squirrel problem next door some time ago. I had the red squirrels and find the right size trap, just how to spring it. So I catch the 18 I had to take out of there because they were visiting. I didn't really like them for guests, and I spread them around the countryside. I hope somebody else is happy with it now. So, but anyway, Dick is a person I've known quite a few years, and he lives in Hebron today. He's a Maine native. He graduated from the University of Maine in 1969 as an agricultural engineering major. He for some years, worked at a dairy farm, then was a milk tester, and for the past 18 years has been with the Paris Farmers Union. He's been on the board, he said, he didn't know how long, but quite a while, of the Oxford County Agricultural Society, which is the actual name of the fair. He's been a selectman in Hebron, and he's also been a mason and active in the Shrine. A very active community person, and of course a good citizen in the town of Hebron, which is one of our neighboring towns in Oxford County. He's here to talk to us about the history of the fair, and I'm looking forward to it, and I know all of you are, because it's something that's been with us for a long time, and we've always felt sad that the fair had to move from the corner where it was for so many years, where Oxford Hills High School is, but it's still going on, and some of you may go to the fair now, and it's one of those things I think we always treasure, because our memories of fairs are very important to us. So, without any further ado, Richard Deans.
Thank you, Arthur. Good evening. As Dan said, we've known each other for quite a number of years, and it wasn't just down the hall, it was across the hall. Each other about every day. Because I've been, as he said, involved with the fair for quite a number of years. My mother's a native from Waterford, Maine, and so we always used to go to the World's Fair. And when I moved to Hebron and was a milk tester for a number of years in Oxford County, I had the bulk of the day off in the middle of the day, so I was always at fair time, go down and hang around the Oxford Fair, cattle department up in the polling department, and just visited, and before I know it, they said, well, you're here enough, you want to be on the board of directors. So, about a year ago, actually 2 years ago, we were talking about the history of the fair, what we could do when having a antique display and working on the history of the fair. And Elaine Emery, who had been giving some of these talks around, wasn't able to do them all, so she says, why don't you try it? So the first one I gave was to the Hebron Historical Society. And in February, I was asked to go and present one to the Rumford. Dan called me and invited me here. And I understand from the grapevine there's a few more that want to hear this talk. The history of Oxford County Agricultural Society was started in 1836. There was an attempt was made to start the Agricultural Society. An act was drawn up to incorporate it, but due to financial constraints on it, they didn't follow through on it, and so a period of years, 4 years actually passed, and on April 13th in 1841, another attempt was made to institute the Agricultural Society, and this is the basis of the present society, which celebrates its 150th year in September. The first officers of the fair were Chairman Joe Prince and Secretary Isaac Harlow. And back then, when they had gatherings, they always had somebody from the Department of Agriculture come and give a presentation once a year. And Dr. Ezekiel Holmes out of Winthrop was the first one to deliver the address to this new society. And he gave that address for several years afterwards, and then they got others involved. On August 24th, 1842, the organization became incorporated and adopted the official name of the Oxford County Agricultural Society, but it's more commonly known as the Oxford County Fair. On October of 1942, the Agricultural Society had its first fair and cattle show. Now, they didn't always have a place to hold this, so whoever had an empty field and could accommodate everybody, that's where they went. They held them in Bethel, Canton, Nolley, Paris. And then in 1856, the fair acquired the 13 acres of land where the present high school is for their home, and they started constructing buildings. From 1842 until 1856, it operated as a two-day fair. And every year, around October, they would have an annual meeting. And in the year 1852, on October 6th, the annual meeting was held, and one of your own was elected president for that year, and it was Moses Mason. Fair admission, in the 1800s, the adults would pay 25 cents, children were 10 cents, and a horse and carriage was 25 cents. Everybody seemed to come to the fair. In 1902, it was the 60th running of the fair, and that was a three-day event, and it had the largest turnout, and I think it's probably larger than they have today for turnouts at our fair. But the gate receipts for that day, or for that time, were, they had $80 the first day, and about $2,500 the second day on a Wednesday, and $650 the third day. But that $2,500 that they received, there was 10,000 people on the grounds that day. And that's hard to imagine back in 1902 when it was horse and buggy, the trolley car, the train, having 10,000 people in town. The buildings were permanent buildings on the site, on this 13-acre site, and there was a large exhibition hall that was erected, and that still stands today. It's in the National Historical Registry, so it will be there for a while. I had the opportunity a couple months ago to go and kind of look inside and see what it was. It was a two-story building. It was more area, more space than what they have today for exhibition halls, and that's with three. Everybody seemed to have their own little niche in there. The Nolley Paris Garden Club had a spot they had, and that still stands inside the building. The Granges, the 4-H had their own little section. And downstairs, they had a lot of exhibitors and food people, much the same as it is today. The visit to the fair would provide a variety of subjects, entertainment and information. In the hall, these fairs were the place that you would go to get the new ideas, what's going on in the outside world. So The horse and cattle medicines, human cure-alls, cider mills, sewing machines, parlor organs, a case of bees in an observatory hive, fancy gourds, whips, a dentist chair with all the equipment. The only thing it needed was a patient. groundbreaking plows, steel combination plows, seed plow, champion horse hoe, grappling hay forks, and homemade implements were judged for their usage, and they would receive a top premium of $3. There was also an interesting display of carriages, open wagons, sleighs, piano box buggies, road wagons, and a one-horse carriage. Throughout the years, drawing horses have been one of the big events. Today, there's several different classes that they have. Back then, two classes. Horses weren't quite as big, so they kept the classes down to 1,200 to 1,400 pounds and 1,000 to 1,200 pounds. They would pull the big loads of rock, and oxen had to do it different. Oxen were required to plow a furrow 8 inches deep, 16 inches wide, and in a straight line. And of course, we all know that the farmers back then, they took a lot of pride in their animals because they didn't come very easy to them. And the judging for this was based on the team, the craft, and doing the best work at the least expense of the animal. So they was always concerned for them. In the halls, they exhibited their pastries, the breads, and a bread had to be accompanied by a recipe. In other classes, you could display 10 yards of woven woolen flannel and the best pair of stockings spun and knit by the same person. So it gave you something to do. The premiums in the dairy department were very similar as they are today, but the breeds were simpler. There weren't as many breeds. Durham breed, Devonshires, Herefords, and Ashiers were the breeds of that day. And in 1976, the fair sported 6 dairy breeds and 5 beef breeds. And I believe that was the year that they had all of the barns were full and all the flowing. They had them tied to everything they could. They had so many animals. In the 1800s, the interesting class of that time was the cow that gave the most butter fit in the 2 days of the fair. It would be milked and observed by a committee at 6 o'clock in the morning and 6 o'clock in the evening. And then they would be tested, the butter fat would be tested by the Babcock method, and which was putting sulfuric acid with a quantity of milk, and in a test tube, which had a long, slender neck, and then spinning it in a centrifuge. And the centrifuges at that time weren't electric. A friend of mine who was a milk tester in New Hampshire had a 4-cylinder centrifuge that clamped on the edge of the table, and he sat there and cranked it. And you had to turn that thing, I believe it was, had to spin for 3 to 5 minutes in order to separate the butter fat and bring it up into the neck of the bottle. Or to separate it in the base of the bottle, and then you added water to that to bring it up into the graduated neck, and you read that as a percent. As Stan mentioned earlier, that I was a milk tester in Oxford County for a number of years. And I was there at the tail end of using the Babcock method at dairy farms. I go and collect the samples of milk at all the farms, take it back to my house, and run these samples. And then there was a changeover where they went all computerized and they started sending samples to New York. So I know what the Babcock method was all about. Of course, horse racing came into being at Oxford Fair, and one of the events was a lady driving contest. Now, we have that today, they don't always drive the horses or the oxen, but back back then, a lady had to harness the horse, drive it around the track a half mile, unharness the horse, and hang the harness in the least amount of time. She was judged on her performance, but the big difference was she couldn't take any premium for it. She'd have to have somebody else pick up the award for her. In the 1800s, a male representative had to pick up the award, and they were not permitted to do it. The earliest granges to exhibit at the fair were in 1897, and we had granges from all over, Bethel, Norwood Paris, West Paris, Rumford, Minot, and I believe Hebron was in there too, but as of late it's been reduced down to just three or four that exhibited. The horse racing that came into the fair was in the 1800s, and it was a popular sport in 1891. There was a grandstand that was erected. This grandstand, you can picture something down there that would hold 4,500 people. It was a pretty big grandstand. And I believe there's a picture of it. That's these pictures here were in some of the old premium books that I have, and we've got some premium books I can show you from in the 1800s. This one here, I believe, was taken out of one that was around 1916, but you know, it was early 1900s, and that's the grandstand. That was the year that the judge's stand was on the same side as the grandstand, and it didn't leave people much chance to see the starting line. So at that time, they moved it across the track, and that's what that one is. It shows this particular picture, I believe, is looking out towards the Wilderness Sawmill up along Fair Street now, and towards where the shopping center is. One of the interesting things about the fair, which is no different back then than it is today, was how young lads around the neighborhood would try to get into the fair without paying their 10 cents. One of the races was going on one day, and this young fella started to, because they had a picket fence all the way around it, and this young fella decided he was going to go to the fair. Well, he started to scale that fence, and his heel caught between the picket, and down he went. He was just dangling until some of the race watchers went over to his rescue and got him off the rail. During the 1800s, fair boasted a membership of 800, over 800. And that was because in order to receive a premium, you had to be a member. So those that wanted to exhibit, they became members. The only ones that couldn't draw premiums were minors and ladies. And the dues remained a dollar to join the fair up until 1985, when they were raised to $3. In the 1900s, the fair had increased to a three-day event, and a baby show was added. And the baby show still is one of the more popular events that they have today. They're showing all the young ones from the curliest hair and the nicest laugh or giggling or whatever. One of these, the advertiser used to put out a whole section of their paper supporting the fair, and they told everything that went on during that week. And trustees are very old and getting rather tired, but there is one from part of the advertiser from 1909, and you can see that the print is small, and there's quite a bit of information in there. We also, somebody had located one from, and the only thing, it was so badly worn and tender that they had to take a copy of it, but this was from 1878. This other one is from 1902. And in this one, they were talking about the baby show, and one of the most prominent names that I can recall in the Norway Paris area was Rupert Aldrich, and he was in the show. In 1921, my mother was in the baby show, and she won for being a twin, not identical, because she had a twin brother, but she was there as one of the participants. Of course, with 10,000 people showing up at the fair, they had to come from quite a ways, and some did it by the train, some did it by oxen and wagon, some horse and wagon. And one of the reports was that Moses Young of Hartford started out at 6 a.m. on a Monday morning, and he arrived at the fair at 2 p.m. in the afternoon. And he was driving five pair of oxen and one pair of steers. Another team started out from West Sumner with five pair of oxen, pistol-covered wagon, and arrived at 2 a.m. in the morning. And that is, shows you a picture of them right down here. This picture shows you the fairground. Actually, both of these show you parts of the fairground. And these photos, we've been trying to locate a lot of them, they were, and Miss Libby that had a photo studio in Norway, Paris. And she exhibited, had exhibited a lot of the amateur photographs, people who want to take photos and exhibit and show them. She kind of headed up that at the fair. Miss Libby had photos in 1902 of amateurs displayed, and she also gave a demonstration of the day of etching of pyrography, which was a new thing at that time. But she took a lot of pictures of the fair, and most of the ones I have here tonight are hers. They came out of that shows you the fairgrounds, the main entrance, the exhibition hall that still stands down there, and in the foreground you can see the trolley tracks. This next one I found last night, and it's not a very good one, but you get the idea. That's the main entrance as they had it. It was just a pass-through. You could go through with horse and wagon. But I'll leave these on display so you can all take a look at them. This is another one. It was a social event. Everybody came. It was a kind of the annual time to get together and visit with everyone, see what was new going on, and that shows the grounds looking from just kind of south of the street light there over towards that exhibition hall and the grounds. And this one here is over at the racetrack. It looks like they're trying to get ready to sell a nice racehorse. Being a social event, it's been noted that the town of West Paris would actually close down for the day, and everybody would jump the train and ride to South Paris, and then get shuttled back over to the fairgrounds and make a day of it. They'd take their picnic lunch, and the Pine Grove cemetery as it is today used to be where everybody went to have the picnic lunch, just off the fairground. The 1910, work was started on the grandstand for the pulling ring, and the fair cut the timber on the, off their own land and had it milled out in order to build that. The seating capacity of that was 1,000 people, and it was not roofed the first season, but the next season it was, and at that time the admission had to be increased from 25 cents to 35 cents. And we had automobiles to contend with, so they charged 50 cents. 1912, the 4-H boys and girls, they started exhibiting at the fair. Much the same as it is today. There's been Boy Scouts and Girl Scouts. And, at that time, they increased the length of it from 3 days to 4 days. By 1930, the fair was growing all the time, and they added another day to 5 days, which kind of held until for another 20 years until 1950, when we went to six. And six held until right around mid-70s, when we went to a seven-day fair. And now, last year and this year, we're going to have a four-day fair. The fair has been, has had its catastrophes. In 45, fire destroyed the cattle barns, and by the 1946 season, they were right back there again. The fair directors all pitched in, and they rebuilt what was destroyed. And then several years later, the pulling grandstand was also destroyed, and again, the following year, it was back in place. In the 1950s, there was such a large turnout of animals that they had to erect a tremendous tent at the end of the cattle barns to house the excess. And that was all fine. Everybody had a good time seeing the animals under the tent until about 4 o'clock one afternoon, a big hailstorm came and collapsed the tent. Now, it stayed on top of all those oxen for about 3 hours. The only way you knew that there's anything underneath there was the horns were sticking up through the top of it, and there would be an occasional boom of the tented animal underneath. So the fair stayed where it was for another 15 years until about 1964, when the school department decided that would make a nice place for a new school district or a school building. So a lot of resistance on their part, and going through the court and eminent domain, the grounds were sold to the SAD 17 for the new present high school. But that didn't end the fair, because there was a group of real dedicated people, directors, that continued on with their meetings and striving to continue on with their show. So they met and in 1969 purchased approximately 100 acres just off 26, right behind what's now Viking Motors. And they put up a exhibition hall and opened up with a 3-day event. And since that time, it has grown from 3 days to 7 days, and now we're back to a 4-day event because everything was getting kind of spread out, and we consolidated and had a good year last year, and looking forward to another year this year, 150. In 1978, the first woman director was elected to the board. And since that time, there's been several others who have served. In fact, the officers this year are President Roger Smedberg, Vice President Phil Jackson, probably a lot of you know. that's one of the things that I've done. And then these Libby photos that I mentioned earlier, I kind of got them together and made a grouping of them so that you can see what it used to be. So my son brought in this fair ad, which ran in 1898. That was a poster that advertised the fair for those days, and it was located in one of those antique shops down in Norway, across South Paris. And purchased it, and it was, you could get up close to it and see that it's been folded and well worn, but just had that frame so we could display that. They continued on, the directors and the officers continued on more strategy planning with the regular meetings on what to do now that they had this money and they just were looking for land. And it was between 64 and 69 that they found that the property that they're on now.
But they didn't have any fairs in those years?
They didn't have any fairs. They were suspended from that.
Do you know how much money they got for the property?
The only thing that I've been able to see, they got about the third the worth because they took it from it by eminent domain.
Right.
I just, coincidentally happened, I was talking to a salesman that was in the store this morning, and he said, if you ever want to talk to somebody about who got the job of dismantling all those old buildings down there, he says, I got the job, my brother and I, we tore down all those big buildings, and he said that the big timbers that they made the grandstand out of, I think they was 12 by 12 timbers, were torn out and were sold to a moving contractor down in the Lewiston Auburn area for blocking up buildings. He said that that was all what is intended together.
When did they start the education day that they have had recently? When did that start?
It's been going, 4 years now?
I think it's 4 years.
My wife teaches at the Guy Rowe School in fifth grade, and she was working with Jim Chandler from the Soil Conservation Service to get that off the ground. I believe it started out with a few hundred kids the first year, and last year they had somewhere around 1,000 going through that day.
What has become of the use of that old exhibit building, and who owns that now?
The old exhibition hall?
Mm-hmm.
That is part of the SAD 17 complex. It would be nice if it could be moved down off that and moved down to the fairgrounds, but as I said before, it was a tremendous big building. It's, when you walk in the back door, it has to be a good 10 to 12 feet to the second floor to double. If you've been over to the Freiburg Fair, the big exhibition hall there, if you go up the side, then there's a platform and you go up again. Well, that's what it is down here.
How do you look on the growth of the Freiburg Fair? Is that a help or detriment to Foster County?
Actually, Freiburg Fair is helping some of the smaller fairs in this area. They, if you read the paper, they gave a monetary contribution to Waterford, Ossipee, and Oxford Fair in January. For improvements. They came came to Oxford Fair because we had talked about doing some better bathroom facilities and whatnot. They donated a bathroom that they're pulling, dismantling to reconstruct it, and that's going to be moved to Oxford Fair. They're in the process of that right now. So actually, they want to see the small fairs continue. I know we're pretty close to their fair dates, but we still have record numbers coming through. I guess every year for the last two or three years, we've had record numbers. Anything else? All right, thank you all for sitting there and putting up with a few little stories of the fair, and hope it was enjoyable to you. Things out, so you can just take a look.
Thank you very much, Dave.
One of them.